This program is made possible by the friends and partners of Unspeakable Joy TV. Coming up this week on Unspeakable Joy with Pastor Tyler Galdon.
A four-part prophetic series on the days of Noah and the days of Lot.
It's still in the palm of the hand of God. And no matter how out of control it gets, God is still in control of it all. And it will bring peace, and it will bring hope, and it will bring assurance, and it will bring authority that God knows. So here is what we want to do today. We want to know, what then do the storm clouds of the days of Noah look like, and are we living in those days?
Are we living in the last days? Is Jesus coming soon? Hear what the Bible says as we go into part three of the series, The Days of Noah and the Days of Lot.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed.
Let's look, if we can, let's kindly focus our hearts tonight on verse 28. And I want to talk to you this morning, we talked about the days of Noah. Tonight, I want to talk to you about the days of Lot. Luke chapter 17, we'll read in verse number 28. We'll find a text verse in verse 29. The Bible says, likewise also as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they builded. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even thus shall it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed. Remember what we said this morning. We talked a little bit this morning that the coming of the Lord is like a lightning bolt. You don't know when it comes. You don't know where it will strike. But Jesus is coming. We said, what follows a lightning bolt? Thunder. But what is it that precedes a lightning bolt? And that is the storm clouds. Jesus said, my coming is going to be like a lightning bolt. It will boom. Before you know it, it will have already happened. You see, the coming of the Lord Jesus is going to happen. But He does not leave His people ignorant. Listen, brothers and sisters, God would not have you to be ignorant. He would not have me to be ignorant. And so what He says is, I'm not going to tell you the day nor the hour when the Son of Man will come. He said, I'm not going to tell you when the lightning is going to strike. He said, but I will tell you what the storm clouds will look like as they roll in. We said this morning that the first set of storm clouds that come in will be that things will look like it did in the days of Noah. We established that there were seven different things, if my mind serves me correctly, seven different characteristics of the day that Noah entered into the ark. And I think we established fairly well, are we or are we not living in the days of Noah? But it's not just that intersection. Because the days of Noah come and they go and they come and they go. But Jesus said, when you see the storm cloud of the days of Noah intersect with the storm clouds of the days of Lot, when those two sets of days come together, He said, then you'll know that I am nigh at the gate. The Bible is clear that my people are destroyed for one reason. My people are not destroyed because of the enemy. God's people are not destroyed because they don't walk right or look right. Why are the people of God destroyed? For lack of knowledge. The scripture tells us that in the day that fire and brimstone rained down upon Sodom, that the people were just walking and talking and breathing and living and eating and drinking and married and just acting like everything was okay until the first fireball hit the ground. They thought everything was okay. He said, that's the way it'll be like in the world. He said, don't think that the people in the world are going to see all the stuff and get amazed. He said, nope. He said, until the lightning bolt, boom. He said, they'll be acting like they always have. He says, but you. He says, lift your eyes up to the skies and see if the spiritual clouds are rolling in. We said this morning, the storm clouds of Noah's days are here. The question is, are we in the days of Lot? Because the question is not if they will intersect, but are they intersecting today? Jesus said, it's coming. Before that I get into that, let me tell you a little bit about Lot. We find, in order to find this, you've got to take your Bible and go all the way back to the book of Genesis chapter 19. So take your Bible and go all the way back to the book of Genesis chapter 19, because in Genesis 19 is where the specific time that Jesus refers to, and that's the time of the raining down of fire and brimstone in Sodom and Gomorrah. That's where we find Lot, but that's not the first time we met Lot. The first time we meet Lot is way back in the book of Genesis, chapter number 13, 14, and 15. And in those chapters, we find that Lot is the nephew of brother Abraham, that righteous man of God. He's the nephew, Lot's daddy. His name, well, his father was Abraham's brother. And so when Abraham comes out of the Ur of the Chaldees, he takes with him his household and Lot's household. And Lot goes out, but we quickly find that while both of these men believe in the one true God, there's a big difference between the two of them. We find that Abraham stays true and Lot backslides, but there's a typology. You see, God gives the Old Testament according to 1 Corinthians so that we can have examples. And so the scripture tells us and teaches us that Abraham is a type and Lot is a type. I want to show you what those are. Abraham is a type of the true believer, and Lot is a type of a backslidden believer. When you read in the Bible about Abraham, what you are reading is the story of a man who loved God, walked with God, and even when he failed God, he made it right with God. You see, I've told you so many times that life is not about your missteps and misfires. We all fail the Lord. We all mess up on God. It's not about the stumbles. You are not a failure if you fail. A true failure in the eyes of God is one that allows the failure to hold them back. Brothers and sisters, how many of you are perfect and have never messed up? I didn't think so. How many of you have messed up? The Lord knows that. That's why 1 John 1:9 is in the book. If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us. It's not about our failures. It's about the grace of God that washes and cleanses us from all unrighteousness. But Lot's not like that. Lot is one that constantly, every time you see him, is going down, 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 down. Every time you see Lot, he's getting further away and further away and further away from God until ultimately he ends up in Sodom. And even after God delivers him from Sodom, you know what Lot does? He goes and he lays with both of his daughters and has a baby with both of them. He's a picture of a backslidden believer. So when you keep that in your mind, here's what you need to understand. If Genesis 19 are the days of Lot, then Genesis 18, 17, 16, and 15 are the lead up in the believer's family, in the family of God. They're the lead up to the last days. So what we find in Genesis, some of y'all are looking at me crazy. Let me tell you, in 15, 16, and 17, God gives us a glimpse of what the believer, the house of God, will be like leading up to the judgment. Let me give you an example and see if we're living in the buildup. There's three things that stick out about the family of God, Abraham and Lot. Number one, in Genesis 13, 7, we find that there is strife among the brethren. You remember Abraham and Lot get mad at each other because the land didn't big enough to house all their cattle? And they got mad over donkeys and cows and sheep, and they split. And there's this strife, this butting of heads between two people that claim to believe in the one true God. And in the days leading up to the last days in the church, do you know what there will be? Strife among the people of God. You take your little journey tonight, anywhere down Church Street, you'll see a plethora of different names. You'll see the First Baptist, the Second Baptist, the Fifth Baptist. You'll see the Church Street Baptist, the Stephen Memorial Baptist. You'll see the Methodist. You'll see the African Methodist. You'll see the European Methodist. You'll see the Korean Methodist. Then over here, you'll see the Lutheran. Then you'll see this. And we don't talk to them, and they don't talk to us, and we don't like them, and we don't agree with them. And then there are doctrinal differences, and we got all that. We don't believe in heresy. But there are people inside of cities that believe just like what we believe, hold the same Bible, but they don't like us. You know why? Because God blesses this church and God doesn't bless that church, and God gives us this ministry and doesn't give us that ministry. And this brooding jealousy in the last days among the people of God. Y'all must not experience that with any of the people in your family that claim to be Christians, but people act like raging maniacs and they claim to be Christians. And I'll be honest, I sit back and I scratch my head, and I know my wife gets so tired of me complaining and whining and moaning about this stuff, but it baffles me that there can be strife among people that believe the same thing. And you can't do anything about it. You can talk to them, they get mad. You can try to eat with them, they get madder. You try to help them, they get more angry. And I sit there and I say, God, why is this getting like this? You know why? Because we are in the stream of God's sovereign prophecy, and there's just nothing we can do about it. He says the buildup in the family of God, there'll be strife. Number two, there'll be a separation from true religion. We find that in Genesis 13. You know what Lot finally says, Brother Bob? He says, Abraham, I understand you've got your ways, but I want to go down to Sodom. I hear it's well watered down at Sodom. I hear they got pleasure down at Sodom. And I'll still believe in God. I'll still believe in salvation. I'll still believe in the one God. But I'm going to do it down in the pit of Sodom with my pleasure and my fun and my sin and my this and my that. And you see this true believer begin the backsliding process. And what God is trying to say is in the church of Jesus Christ as a whole, you'll know you're in the last days because those that have professed Christ as a church will begin the process. We used to believe that. We used to go there. We used to act that way. But now we find we can do just as much down in Sodom. It's not as bad down in Sodom. I talked about it this morning. I'll hit on it again. Some of you, you've got family and friends, and maybe you've even been in that world, and churches look like rock shows. They look like concerts. The preacher is this. The deacons are that. There is no structure. There is no way. Come as you are. Leave as you were. Go, come, breathe, don't breathe. It doesn't matter. There is no rule that the Holy Spirit leads. There is no way that the Word of God is law. It's just whatever. But you've got these people, and they say, yeah, I still believe. Does anybody else not just get stark, raving, angry over that thing? I'm thinking, there ain't no way you're believing what I'm believing and reading what I'm reading and you acting like you acting. Is that not I'm just telling you, my mind is... Look, I know I'm an old man in a young man's body. I know I'm a fuddy-dud. I know I don't do anything but get up early, read, and stay up late. I got all that. But there are just some things that blow my mind. And I sit and I say, what do you mean you're going that way? What do you mean you're walking in that path? And I say, stop. And they don't listen. And I say, what do I do to stop it? And you realize there's nothing you can do. Because it's the stream of God's sovereign plan. The church will be that way at Laodicea. Here's the third thing. There was a rejection of true deliverance. Do you remember what happened in chapter 17? Lot begins to go down to Sodom, and he gets taken over by a wicked king whose name is Chedorlaomer. And Chedorlaomer, he takes Lot and all these people, and Abraham goes and rescues him, delivers him. But what does Lot say to Abraham? He says, I'm still going to Sodom. How many of your family members have you prayed for? How many of your family members that have been in mess and they've been a part of this world of mess and you have seen God deliver them? You've seen God give them chance after chance after chance after chance after chance only to have them say, thanks for rescuing me. I'll see you in Sodom. And it blows my mind. Do you know why? That's the way it will be in the house of God in the last days. Are we living in the days of Lot? Seems like we are. Let me give you the characteristics. There are six characteristics of the days of Lot. Are you in Genesis 19? I'll show these to you if you'll let me. In Genesis chapter 19, there's six characteristics of the days of Lot. In verse 4, we find in the days of Lot, there is unbridled immorality. Notice what it says in verse number 4 of chapter 6. The Bible says, and before they lay down, this is the angels that have come into the city, the men of the city, even the men of Sodom, compassed the house round about, both old and young, and all the people from every quarter. Here in those days, here's what's going to happen. In those days, what you're going to find is that there will be this unleashing, not just depravity. It won't just be people killing each other and beating each other and hitting. It will be sexual immorality on a scale we have never ever comprehended. Once again, I was looking and I typed in the word on Google News. I typed in the word rape. And all the stuff comes up. All the news articles come up. But there was one that came up that took place in London just a couple of days ago. And here's what happened. There was a man that was bailed out of prison by his own mother. She bailed him out of prison and she threw a coming home party for him. He was in his mid-30s or 40s, whatever he was. She threw a coming home party for him. They all got drunk. You know what she did? She went to bed and he went in and raped his own mother. They asked, what were you thinking? Here's his answer. I thought it'd be fun. And you and I that have grown up and you that are much older than I, you can remember the Andy Griffith days and it doesn't fathom. And we look and we say, over the last 10 years, it feels like the linchpin has been pulled out of this thing. Do you know why? Because in the last days, in the days of Lot, it will encompass the young and the old. And there will be an immorality. There are kids in this room, teenagers, young kids. They're hooked on pornography because they learned it from mama and they learned it from daddy. Young kids, teenagers, moms and dads. My wife asked me just the other day, she said, do you really think pornography is that big of an issue? I said, I do not know statistics. I don't deal with that. But I believe if we had to chalk it up in this room and among the church of Jesus Christ, how pornography has touched probably every single house. It's an unbridled immorality. God says it would be that way. The second thing that we find in the days of Lot, the unbridled immorality, number two, there would be rampant homosexuality. We find in verse number 5, the Bible says, and they called unto Lot and said unto him, where are the men which came into thee this night? Bring them out unto us that we may know them. The word know, it's the Hebrew word yada. It means to have an intimate sexual relationship with. Here you've got men outside the house, young and old, men of every race and every color, every genre, everything. And here they are, and they're beating the door down just to have a sexual relationship with the angels, the men that have come into the city. Everywhere you go, it's everywhere, he said. You couldn't go from house to house, from place to place. It's everywhere in Sodom. Over the last 15 years, I look at from in my lifetime, I'm 33, I'll be 34 years old this year, in my lifetime, from the time I was 17 to today, There are things that are rules of law today that I had never even heard of 15, 20 years ago. Some of you sit here and you rack your brain and you say, I just can't even believe it. And you got Republicans screaming on one side. You got Democrats screaming on the other side. You got independents screaming on both sides. You got this preacher screaming this, telling everybody they're all filthy, low-down, good-for-nothings. You got this one over here that's just cow-licking everybody into hell. And you're saying, where is the truth? And God says in the last days, Bob, He says they'll be so depraved. Homosexuality. It's not about the homosexuality. It's now when you say it's wrong, we have a problem with you. I read an article the other day. I had meant to have all this up there. This girl, she was 8 years old. And they were having Gay Pride Day at her school. This young black girl was 8 years old. She lived at home with a single mother, and that mother evidently had done everything she could to teach her about God and the ways of God. And she went up to her teacher. They said, very politely went up to her teacher and said, Miss So-and-so, would it be okay if I didn't come to class? I'll go into another class that day. They suspended her, they expelled her, and tried to bring charges against her mother. And I'm just going to be downright honest with you. That black lady in there, I don't even want to tell you what she said, but she said, let me just tell you something right now. She said, I birthed that girl. I raised that girl. I paid for that girl. You can expel her. You can suspend her. But it is right, wrong, yada, yada, yada. But here's what I got on. And I mean, how'd you like to have been that principal? I mean, absolutely. You can see her walking in there right now. And I mean, just lamb black, just pow, just a pow, just a pow with that finger. But here's the problem. They said the principal looked at her and said, what's wrong with you? Because in the days of Lot, right will be wrong. And wrong will be right. You and I look around, we say, what's going on? Just the days of Lot intersecting. Here's a third one. Verse number 8, we find that there'll be abandoning parents. There'll be a rapid influx of parents that forsake their children. In verse number 8, let me show you what Lot says when these men beat on the door, beat on the door, beat on the door. Verse number 8, watch what Lot says. He says, behold, I have two daughters, and they're virgins. Never known a man. Take them and do with them what you want. Can you imagine a father saying that? You know what Lot said? Lot said, just get out of my hair. You can do what you want to. Does that not sound like many parents that we know in 2019? I want to do my thing. I want to go my way. I'm getting ready to hoe in somebody's tater patch right here. And some of you have got children that have done this and you're raising grandchildren. Some of you are single mothers or single fathers because somebody said, I'd rather do this. I'm going to go do my own thing. I'm going to go walk in my own way. I'm going to go be my own thing. And you're sitting back here thinking, what? You told me for better or for worse. Where is this coming from? I'll tell you where it's coming from. There is a massive influx in the days of Lot where people will say, you just do what you want to do. I don't care. You can have my youngins. You can have my babies. You can have my family. You can have my kids. You can have my marriage. You can have it all. Just let me do. Get out of my hair. Stop bothering me. Stop messing with me. Stop confusing. Just leave me alone. And that will happen in the days of Lot. And let me just take a time out and say something that I did not write down in my notes, but I think I probably should have. I want to encourage some of you moms and dads that are getting lamb blasted from every single side about how you're trying to raise your children in the ways and the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. That same crowd that's throwing their kids over to the devil and that same crowd that's handing their kids over to hell, don't you listen to what they have to say on how you raise your youngins and how you tell your youngins about Jesus and how you keep them in church and how you don't let them do this and how you love them in that. You let God be God. Do what God says. And you let those that will forsake their kids and not keep you forsaking yours. Hear me now and hear me well. In the days of Lot, they'll just be a massive. I've got a Gallup poll. They said in our day, over 1/3 of kids will be raised in single parent homes. Some of you old-timers can't even fathom the the numbers. He says, in the days of Lot, they'll be abandoning parents. Number four, in verse 11, in the days of Lot, there'll be spiritual blindness. The Bible says in verse 11 that the angels, they smote the men that were at the door of the house with blindness, both small and great, so that they wearied themselves to find the door. Any time in the Bible that you see blindness put on somebody, it is a type of being spiritually blind. It's a type of being unable to see truth. It's unable to see what is right and what is wrong. So when these angels smote these people with blindness, they could no longer see the angels of God. They could no longer see the deliverers that had come to save the city. Ladies and gentlemen, where are we living today? It's not this mindset anymore of, well, you just do your thing and I'll do my thing and we'll go our separate ways. No, no, no. There is an absolute, I don't understand what you're talking about this God thing. I don't understand what you're talking about. This Jesus thing. What do you mean there's one Savior and one way to heaven and only this and that? What do you mean? There is a blindness that comes over. Brothers and sisters, America has never been Christian. It's never been a Christian nation ruled and run by Christians, but it has been friendly to Christianity. But today, we are no longer friendly to Christianity, but to true God-honoring religion, we are now hostile. I'd have said it this morning. I'm more than happy to go to the Friendly Center and start naming the name of Jesus and preaching. You watch what they do to us. They hate it. Why? Because God says in that day of Lot, I'll strike them with blindness. They won't even be able to understand. How many of you have got loved ones not saved and you've tried to talk to them, but it's like they doesn't even register. What is that?
Would you like to see where our Savior walked? See where He taught and prayed? Where He was crucified and rose again? Join Pastor Tyler Galdon on a 10-day, life-changing journey through the Holy Land. On this special journey, we will trace the prayers of our Bible. Prayers like Jesus' prayer of agony in Gethsemane, Elijah's prayer for fire on Mount Carmel, and so many more. For more information on this all-inclusive tour and how you can journey with us, please visit TylerGalden.com or call us at 336-375-4218. Space is limited, so register today. Sail on the Sea of Galilee, walk through the temple ruins, and see your Bible come alive in the land of our Lord, the Holy Land. Thank you for watching this broadcast of Unspeakable Joy with Pastor Tyler Galdon. Our prayer is that you have been challenged and changed by the power of God's Word. Unspeakable Joy is only able to broadcast on this station through the regular prayers and financial support of people just like you. Would you consider becoming a monthly partner of Unspeakable Joy? You may mail your gifts to Unspeakable Joy, 3113 North Church Street, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27405. Or you can give online at unspeakablejoytv.com. Be assured that God's Word has the answer for your every need, that you may rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory.